All right, let's jump in. Thanks everyone for joining today, our global webinar. We're really excited to have people signed up from all over the world. And actually my co-presenter, Martin Ender, is joining us from Poland. So let's jump into some introductions and then what we're gonna be talking about today. I'm Michelle Roberts, I'm the VP of Key Accounts here at Finch. I've been in the digital space for the last 10 years and at Finch for the last four. I started in vertical specific industries like the auto industry at a company called dealer.com and then the hospitality industry. And I wasn't looking to make a change, but Finch was pretty persuasive in their recruitment. And ultimately I ended up wanting to work with them because I just loved the way they were approaching the paid search world, automating a lot of the things that I thought were kind of mundane and time consuming, freeing me up to focus more on the strategic point of things as well as beta testing and really just getting more engaged with our clients. So now I have the privilege of working with our top clients, really starting in the sales process, more from a technical standpoint, and then ongoing from a strategy perspective. I also manage all our relationships with Google, Bing, and Amazon, and help bring our top level clients that extra level of support. And then I get to put on fun events like this. Quick background on Finch, also been around for 10 years. Really, we are an all-encompassing marketing technology platform. As I mentioned, automation is a big part of that. We automate and optimize search, shopping, and display. And then we tie that all together with cross-channel insights reporting. It's great to have good performance, but if you don't have a solid reporting platform and something that you can take actionable data out of, it's kind of all for naught. And then we pull that all together in our collaboration piece, which is really kind of a project management system, but takes it up a level since we're so goal-oriented and performance-driven here at Finch. It allows us to see the goals of our clients and then tie specific reports from insights to it so everybody can be on the same page and monitor how things are going. Also pretty proud that we're doing obviously the shopping webinar today, and one of the biggest in the industry, Google has recognized us for our performance in this. We've received both the Shopping Performance Partner Award and the Search Innovation Partner Award. So it's nice to have the recognition and see the work that we're doing for our clients be highlighted like that. I'd like to turn it over now quickly to my co-presenter, Martin Ender, so he can present himself and what he's going to be talking about today as well.
Yes, thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. Good morning from Poland, from Krakow. My name is Martin. I'm working right now as the VP of Sales and Country Manager for the German market at DataFeedWatch. A few years ago, I actually moved from Germany to Poland, and where I just started to work at Google in the AdWords as an AdWords account specialist for 1.5 years. And then I just switched to DataFeedWatch, where I'm working now since 3.5 years. I'm managing a lot of accounts of small clients, of big clients like Adidas, but I'm also working closely together with the agency Finch. It's very nice to have this partnership, and we also did already a few webinars, also some events in the past with Timo from Germany. So it's very nice to see you all guys here today. Thank you so much for signing up for this webinar. Today I'm going to explain a bit more about what a data feed is, what a product data feed is. So we at DataFeedWatch, we are actually more now than just a very simple data feed management tool. In the last few quarters, we actually worked more on developing a great service for our clients to help them to connect their store with DataFeedWatch. So for example, if you have a Shopify or Magento store, we just download all the product data to us, and then we are able to create different data feeds within just a few clicks. For example, for Google Shopping, for Bing, for Amazon, for eBay, but also for custom channels in B2B and B2C. And so this is relevant for everyone who's using any product feeds, data feeds for different channels. But today we are actually going to focus on Google Shopping, and this is what Michelle is going to start to talk about.
Perfect, thank you. So quick agenda, what we're gonna be going over today, really focusing on brands and manufacturers in the e-commerce space. A lot of people start maybe in brick and mortar, or they're selling through retail partners. And this is really gonna be about, is this the right time for you to be selling directly online? And especially given current situation with coronavirus, the answer is probably yes. once you decide if that's something you want to give a go, there's a number of options when it comes to Google Shopping. We have the smart shopping, we have standard, we now have free, which you might have heard about and we'll jump into. So we'll kind of go through those different things. Then we're going to focus on how having more data and more control is going to give you more actionable insights and ability to control the outcomes of what you're trying to achieve. As mentioned before, all of this is a little bit pointless if you don't have proper reporting to see how it's going and where you need to make adjustments. Then Martin's going to talk to us about how you can make your feed great again. Great title. Because it's such a huge part of shopping. You really need that fundamental feed to be in a good position in order to have the best opportunity to succeed. And of course, we'll leave time at the end for some questions and answers. So if questions come up along the way, feel free to drop them in the chat and then we'll see those at the end. So let's get started. First of all, just kind of looking at what are the pros and cons of doing this. I'm actually going to start right to left because I like ending on a positive high note. So if we look at the cons, you're probably going to have less revenue through retail partners. You're also probably going to need additional resources to set up your online store, make sure everything's in the right place and able to serve. B2C logistics can be a bit more complex. And there's also the fact that you're going to have to handle all your own product data, although this can actually really be a positive thing. Potentially there's some less scalability in that you're selling direct and it's more of those one-offs as opposed to bulk orders to retail partners. And there's probably going to be a little bit more work from your client services team and just ensuring the product and the warranty. On the pro side though, get a lot more control, including price. You get to set the price. It's not something you have to negotiate through your partners. And you're going to get better margins because you're not paying them a piece of that portion. And you also have the direct customer contact, so you can really start to control what that whole journey looks like, become very customer-centric, and decide how you want to approach these things. I would say right now that's more important than ever. All the data that we've seen is that consumers are really taking into account how businesses are handling things during this special time, how they're treating their customers, and we've seen a lot of data around customers going with new brands that they never went with before, simply in how they're reacting to the coronavirus situation and then staying with them long term. So it's nice to have that level of control during this and have an overall better brand experience. And then probably one of the most important things is now you own that customer data, and what you can do with that is pretty endless. A couple quick examples of brands that have made this work really well. Glossier is obviously a well-known beauty product company, and the beauty industry is fairly saturated, but they were actually able to carve out a niche by selling directly and looking at the data and understanding where their customers were and knowing that they could be super successful on social media. So just selling directly and having that customer data enabled them to succeed in this heavily saturated market. Another one is Burton, which is kind of close to my heart. I grew up in the small state of Vermont, and Burton is headquartered there. So they had a little bit different approach. They started in the 1970s, were always selling through partners, and then in about 2010, they decided they were going to start selling directly to their customers. At first, it didn't go over the best with their retail partners, but the retail industry realized that things are evolving and that you can do both. So they've successfully actually made it work by still selling through retail partners, brick and mortars, and selling directly online. So as digital marketers or marketers in general, we are generally always looking for growth. What channels are always growing? Well, some of the biggest ones are obviously Amazon and Google. And there's also display, which really has an infinite reach. And I would say Bing can't be discredited as well because they're continuing to grow and have great offerings. I know a lot of companies that did really well organically for many years, and then all of a sudden they're starting to plateau. I mean, at the end of the day, Google is a company that needs to grow and answer to shareholders, so that continued monetization of the first page is only going to continue. So really that next level of growth does come at a cost. However, your reach is infinitely more than say a brick and mortar or even just through your retail stores, which are on the decline, especially given the current situation. So let's say that you have decided that you do want to get started on this, or at the very least, you want to give it a test. where do you begin? There's a lot of options out there. There's a lot of information, and we're going to dive into what all of these are specifically broken down. You've probably heard a lot of buzz lately around how Google, selling on Google is now free. I mean, that sounds amazing, but at the end of the day, we all know there's no such thing really as a free lunch. Actually, coincidentally, Google does provide free lunch, but I think in some way you end up paying for that, whether it's working extra hours or whatnot. So they do have a free portion, but we're gonna dive into specifically what that means. So this is what it looks like. One thing that's important to know is it isn't just the main page when you go to do a Google search. You actually specifically have to go to the shopping tab, and this is where the free portions can show up. Right now, there's still not a ton of data. It's pretty new, but I do have an unofficial quote that about 3% of all traffic can end up here and looking at the free portion. That could still be a lot for some industries, but at the end of the day, it's probably a pretty small portion. So when we're focusing on growth, we're probably going to have to do a little bit more than just this new free part of it. This is actually an example because it is live in the US and India currently. And it's supposed to roll out to the rest of the world pretty shortly, but you can kind of see the difference pretty clearly here in that on the left, we have the paid performance, some days seeing upwards of high 3,000s in clicks. The unpaid portion, the high days looking at about 115. So do we want those free clicks? Of course, but it's probably not going to completely move the needle on your entire digital marketing strategy. So now let's jump into the other options. We'll start with Google Smart Shopping. When you go to set up a shopping campaign, you have the option to set up a smart shopping campaign or a standard shopping campaign. We'll get into the whole naming scheme here in a minute, but let's dive into what specifically smart shopping is. Essentially, this is Google's pitch. They have all of this information, everything from the devices, the systems people are searching on, where they are, the search queries that they're typing in, the intent based on all their other searches, and they're taking all of this information into account to essentially set your bid. So you don't control how much you're bidding on things. Not only that though, you're also getting ad views on other formats like display, YouTube, and Gmail. Therefore, it's not really smart shopping. It's kind of smart everything that Google has to offer. This can be a great solution if you're just wanting something to run and you don't really have the time or the resources to dig further into it and be more strategic. Because unfortunately, there is a bit of a downside to all the shiny smartness of it. I promise this isn't a bad news webinar in that nothing is free and things are too good to be true, but I'm going to talk about how having more control can actually be really good in your overall strategy. So this downside comes in that essentially it's a giant black box. It's actually kind of a black hole for your data. And I'll run through a number of points on this. So again, can be good for some features, but then this is kind of the other side of it. You can't really compare it to traditional shopping because it's something different. As we saw, you can show up on any one of their platforms, and so therefore it's not really the same as shopping. There's also no information around these placements and where you'll be shown. So you don't have any control whatsoever. It might be important to you as a brand or an owner as to where you're showing up. Some sites might just not make sense for you. On the other side of that too, there's also no exclusions. So if you know specifically off the top of your head, I really don't want to be showing up on these industries or these sites, you don't have the ability to say, I don't want to. There's also no search term report. So you don't know what people are typing in to actually lead to you, whether it's super relevant to you or not. And then you can't take that information and apply it to your search campaigns. This one could be a small one, but it might be important to some people that are trying to increase their market share. There's no negative ROAS. And what I mean by that is you can't set it so that you get less than a one-to-one return. You might say, oh, that's fine, but we do have clients that come to us, and whether they have investment money or really lofty goals, they might be wanting to really dominate a certain piece of the market, and they're willing to spend above that and not have a positive return so that they can really start to carve out their niche and own it. you wouldn't have the ability to do that in smart shopping. And then you're ultimately in the hands of Google and the performance and letting them set everything, and your competitors might be as well. So that's why we say you might just want to be aware a little bit of all these different factors that go into the smart shopping. If you don't have the time, it might be the right thing for you. But if you're trying to develop this really comprehensive digital marketing strategy, you're probably going to want a little bit more control over things. One opportunity in smart shopping to try to gain a little bit more control would be the way you structure your campaigns. So if you have certain products that have higher or lower margins, you could group them in different smart campaigns. But if you're starting down this path, you might as well just go with standard campaigns where you have even more control, because essentially now you're just creating black boxes beside each other. So let's talk about what you can do if you don't go down the smart shopping route and have a little bit more control. Rarely do we have clients where all their products are the same price or have the same margin. We all know that. Some drive more revenue and some are just quicker in the turnaround. It's not easily possible to manage every product individually. Well, spoiler alert, we actually do at Finch, but for now, it makes sense to group them in whatever logic drives your business and helps you steer campaigns to success. So this is what a feed looks like. We're going to jump much more into this with Martin in a little bit, but it's important to have good data in your product feed, because in shopping, that is a large factor of determining if you show up in the search results. You can't bid on search terms like you can on the search side of paid advertising. This is why we wanted to invite DataFeedWatch to help share things on how you can do this to set it up for success. So let's look at a way that you can take a little bit more control in the standard version, and that's in the priority options settings. You can bucket things in your campaign, so to speak, based on priority. The idea is to get users in the right bucket based on their likelihood to convert. The higher the likelihood and more targeted their search, the more we're willing to bid on them. Here we could have a generic, a brand, and a product bucket, each triggered with different types of searches that people are doing. So just to look at this in some context, let's say somebody types in rain jacket. That's obviously very generic. They're probably higher up the funnel. They just started their search. They know they need a rain jacket, but they have no idea on the brand or what type. So we want to show up if we are selling rain jackets, but we probably don't want to be spending as much given that they probably still have a ways to go in their buying journey. Now, if someone types in something that specifically involves our brand, say we're Patagonia and somebody types in rain jacket Patagonia, of course we want to be showing up. We don't want our competitors getting that when someone is specifically looking for us. So here we might be willing to be a bit more aggressive. And then finally, if it's just an overall broad product like Torrent Shell 3L jacket, they know specifically kind of what they're looking for, but they haven't necessarily identified a brand. So again, a little bit more further down the funnel than just a generic search, probably we want to be a little bit more targeted and a little bit more aggressive to try to get that click. So the way Finch does it is we isolate all of the data points to the SKU level so that we can get super granular and have complete control over this buying journey, trying to drive where people are clicking to give us the best results. So something unique we do at Finch is that we actually do single product ad groups. And so every single product, whether you have 500 or 500,000, gets its own single product ad group. Now remember, we have a lot of automation behind this to help manage it. And there's a number of reasons to do it this way, but the primary one is that all your actionable data is sitting at the ad group level. This is where you set all your modifiers for device and audience. So if we lumped a bunch of them together, they all have to get the exact same modifier. And the chances of them performing exactly the same on mobile, exactly the same on all your different audiences, are probably slim to none. So by having this granular structure, we can very much depend on the historical data to help us drive our decision-making on how we want to bid. So So there really is no limitation in this. We can still group however we want. We just have the advantage to group products together in high margin, high rolling, top seller, promotional groups, and we can set goals for each group and steer every product and all the bid modifiers towards what we're trying to achieve or what our clients are trying to achieve as a company. We talked earlier about how in doing this, you need to have the proper reporting so that you can make decisions from it. These are a few examples that we've pulled out of our insights report and where we've seen a lot of value added in looking at this. I've seen stats before about how over 50% of digital marketers spend more time gathering data and putting together reports than actually taking any action on them and making decisions based on the data, which is a crazy waste of time. So by having these set reports, we can pretty easily pull insights out and make decisions off from it. This is our top performer report. And this one was kind of a funny example. We had a client that sells like cat stands, kind of those cat tree bed things. And normally it's not a top seller, but during coronavirus, suddenly we noticed a huge demand increasing. It kind of makes all those memes true in that dogs are super excited that their owners are home all the time now and cats are a little bit unamused. So apparently more people needed to buy cat products. So in doing this, we saw this report and that it was on the rise. We were able to work with our client and let them know, hey, you're going to need more inventory here because you're crushing it in this particular product. Another one that's important is previously converting. A lot of times when we need to do some troubleshooting, maybe performance is a little bit down, this is a great report to go to say, okay, these products were crushing it before and now all of a sudden they're not doing anything. So are we out of stock? Are we just having inventory problems? Is the time to deliver suddenly up? And this can help us determine where we need to shift things. If those products that we're doing really well suddenly aren't available to us, we can now shift our strategy to try to push other products that are maybe similar or can help fulfill similar type needs. The custom label report is also really great, and I'm sure Martin's gonna get more into this, how important custom labels can be in a feed, because it's a way for us to kind of sort different things out and control different pieces of information. In this particular report, this one is talking about the time to deliver. And what we noticed was there was a pretty strong correlation between how quickly the client could deliver products and how well it was selling. This kind of makes sense. Generally, faster is better, something that Amazon kind of made famous during all of this, although they seem to be ignoring it a little bit during these times. I don't know if anyone else is peeved that suddenly Prime shipping is 2 weeks instead of 2 days, but I guess it could be worse. So having this type of information, we can see, okay, these products that you're able to fill more quickly are selling better. Let's shift a lot of our budget here, get more aggressive with that bidding so that we can take advantage and capitalize on this. At this point, I want to turn it over to Martin so that he can talk to us about how you can set up your feed in a way that is going to bring you the most success.
Exactly. Thank you so much. Thank you for all the insights about Google Shopping. You mentioned the custom labels a few times. I will definitely go into this a bit deeper in a few slides. Awesome. In the meantime, I would like to thank everyone who just joined this webinar now. I see that we have a lot of attendees today, and I also see a lot of people in there who already use our tool since a longer time in agencies and companies. So who actually does not know about what a data feed is? A data feed is actually the foundation of every Google Shopping campaign. Because if you don't have any data feeds, you are not able to advertise on Google Shopping. So your data feed, which is the product feed, should be accurate, complete, and optimized as much as possible. Because this will actually lead in the end to a higher conversion rate. And today during my part, I would actually like to show you how to optimize the feed and how to avoid issues before you're going to upload your product feed to your Google Merchant Center account. Yeah, so as I said, we actually work since 7 years with several agencies, companies, brand merchants all over the world. We gained a lot of experience in data feed optimization, in data feed creation. So data is actually the power. This is the most important thing in e-commerce. It doesn't matter if you would like to sell on Google Shopping or if it's Facebook, you always need a data feed to be successful there and, of course, to save your time. By the way, if you have any questions, just feel free to ask us at any time in the Q&A window here on this here on Zoom. So let us first start with the website. Of course, every customer, every person who's looking for a product needs to visit a website. So just check, first of all, if your URL of your product is working, if the URL is available, if the domain name is verified, and if also the website is loading in a very short time, because nobody has the time to wait until the website has loaded within a few seconds. So also please try to avoid some redirects on your website itself. One of our customer Adidas, for example, they just created their own report. So they, for example, see which kind of links are broken and include this 404 error. And this separate report, the separate file, will be, for example, uploaded to DataFeedWatch and just excluded from the next feed upload to Google Shopping, because you can just update the feed more times a day, multiple times a day. So if you would like to avoid that people are just clicking on your ad, but this ad won't lead to the final page, then just remove these kind of products which are offline. So here you will see an example of colors. Michelle, if you just click a few times, you will just see that there are just different yellow colors popping up. Exactly. Especially if you work in the apparel branch, it's quite common right now that we use some fancy colors like butter yellow, lemon yellow. Yes, of course, these colors sound nice and can be associated with the color yellow, but I would be careful how you use them. In this case, I would, for example, recommend you to use these kind of fancy colors in the description, but not in the title or not in the field color itself, because then it will be not be accepted by Google. So what we sometimes do is that when we see this kind of color in the title, we just replace it with the basic color, like yellow, red, green, and these color will still stay in the description. Or that we can also do, like, let's say that if you have lemon yellow mentioned in the description, then in this case, we would like to add yellow as the basic color to the title. So you see there are different ways how to optimize your color, how to add some more values to your data feed, by just adding the color out of the description, for example. So here you see two product pictures. On which product picture would you like to click if you're just looking for this kind of shirt? I think that most of you will click on the right picture because it shows the shirt on the person, just how it looks like when you wear that. So we actually noticed that the most people actually prefer to click on the image where a person is wearing that shirt. And you can actually have different product images for one product. You can have it from different angles in different colors so that people will get a better view. So in the end, actually 82% of all of our customers is answered that it will be actually more likely that people are going to click on a shopping ad where someone is wearing this product rather than, for example, just having this product picture or this product on a white background. Let's go to the title. The title is one of the crucial things in the product ads, in the product feeds. So depending on what exactly you are selling in your shop, if it's apparel or if these are electronic products or books, I would definitely recommend you to take a look at the title, because in the most cases, I actually recommend to have the brand in front of the title. So if you just look at the left top corner with apparel, you see that I just choose the brand plus gender, the product type. And then I also added some attributes to the title, like for example, color, size, material. And this will make the title look greater. The consumer will definitely have much more information about the product itself, like which brand, is it for a man or woman, which product type is it, what kinds of size and color material. So you will definitely have way more information in the product title it will also increase and help you to increase your return on investment, because people will definitely look for the right product and will it will be more likely that they're going to look at a nice product picture and then, second of all, read your title. So having this kind of information in your product feed, just to mention here, if your title is not perfect yet, we can definitely help you to improve your title by, for example, adding some more information to the title. We can just match them. We can just combine the title out of these information I just showed you in the slide before. And now on this slide, you actually see a case study by one of our clients up here. They are actually selling baseball gloves. And the original title, what you see in the middle is, for example, Wilson Classic Baseball Glove, and then the model number. So what they did, they just spent some time on doing some keyword research, and they just checked their Google Ads account and just figured out that people are looking for some more specific products. They are, for example, looking for a left or a right-handed baseball glove for youth or for adults, also about the material. And then they just started to redefine the title and just combine them out of different information. So in the end, they just redefined it. And the final result is that they have Wilson Youth Leather Baseball Glove Left-Hand Throw. So this is a more exact title, which contains way more information. And they just applied it to 15% of all the products. And with just this improvement, they have been able to increase their click rate of 250% more clicks within the last few quarters. So this is also an example that you should just spend a little bit of time and take a look also at the keywords from the search results. Next. All right. Good. Coming closer to custom labels and about the timing. There are different ways how to set up which price or which product should be shown when. So here in my screenshot, you just see that I just used the price. For some promotional reasons. Yeah, I have a sale price, I have a promo price due to some seasonal products. So in this case, I just set up that, for example, the new price, the promo price, will be just shown from the 29th of November to the 1st of December, for example, for just a few days. And then it will skip back to the regular pricing. Yeah, so also think about just changing the pricing in the data feed itself. And most of the people in e-commerce actually forget that they can just easily do some A/B testing. So let us first start with the image. It's actually very easy to do an A/B testing if you just use like the a picture where someone is wearing this shirt, or just a product picture where the shirt is just on a plain white background, let's say. Then also play around with the brand name. If you should, let's say, put the brand name in front of the title or at the end of the title. And then also by combining the title in comparison to the old title you just had with less information in it. Then also just check your keywords. Just try to implement some more keywords. Shorter those keywords or use the full length of the keyword in a title. So once again, the AdWords search term report will help you here a lot. I would like to give you some more examples of useful data. First of all, the margin. If you will be able to generate a separate data feed with the gross margin from your shop, this would be perfect, because in this case, you can use your original product feed with your original product data, like the title, description, and so on. Plus adding a second feed, which just contains the product ID and the gross margin. And we can just merge those two feeds. And then we will, for example, see which kind of products have, for example, a better gross margin, so that later on you can better focus on this. And this is actually what I'm going to explain in one of another slides about the custom labels. Also, like I already mentioned with the pricing, just take a look at your seasonal products. It doesn't make sense to sell winter products during the summer season. So for example, you can also filter out that products which include the word winter in the description should be excluded from the next feed upload to Google Shopping. Bestseller products. Just sit down, just create your list of bestseller products. It's very simple. Just create a Google spreadsheet with different product IDs. Just write down your bestsellers. And also one of the next slides, I will show you how to optimize them, how to make how to use them better in your Google Shopping campaign. And yeah, also sale, what I just mentioned, if you have sale on spring and autumn, you can also just focus more on these kind of products then and create some special promo prizes. Yeah, and keywords again. All right, good. And this on this slide, I would like to show you three examples. So the first one, you just need to click a few times now. So the first one are cheap shoes, then we will have mid shoes, and then we will have some more expensive brand shoes. So here, just think about how much you're actually losing on your CPA, how much your lost profit and the profit here is, and how much your gross margin is. So try to focus more on products where you have a great gross margin, where you're definitely going to win on this product. And by creating custom labels, you can, for example, separate this kind of products. And this will definitely help you in creating a better Google Shopping campaign. So this was also one of the things Michelle was just explaining, that you can just better structure your Google Shopping campaign if you are using custom labels effectively here.
A quick note on that too, Martin, at Finch, we use them for another reason as well, in that we can pull that in for optimization purposes. So let's say it's new products, they don't have a ton of data. We're able to pull by custom labels. Let's say you have top sellers or you have a new line that you're really wanting to push, and that can help our software decide how we want to bid on those. So great point. Custom labels just play so many roles.
Exactly. Right. All right, and this is also one of the examples, like I just mentioned. Just create a list of custom label of your bestseller products. And if you're going, for example, to prepare for the Black Friday hot deals, then you can just simply upload a list of all the product IDs, which you definitely would like to push on this Black Friday hot deals. So you can just upload this list, and these products which are in this list will be added to a custom label 0 or 1, for example. And this will be definitely just active during a specific time period, and then it will be turned off again, and then you will just focus again on a custom another custom label, for example. Another point how to optimize your return on investment is actually just by removing unprofitable products. So here you can also, for example, upload a list of products which are, let's say, cheaper than $10, or where you just had, let's say, a bad gross margin in the past, so that these products will be just removed from the whole product feed. But the very simple rule is what I usually do, that I just exclude products which are, for example, out of stock, the price is lower than $10. And what you see here is a screenshot from our Data Feed Watch analytics tool. You just need to go one step back, please. Where you just see that I'm actually looking at products which got, for example, a lot of views, a lot of clicks, but nobody bought this product. And these kind of products you can just simply exclude then. And now in the next step, imagine that, for example, you're selling Adidas sneakers in different sizes. And now, Michelle, now think that let's say half of all these products are already sold out. So let's say somebody is clicking on your product ad. He's looking for this Adidas sneaker, but then he just sees that it's not available in size 8. It's not available in size 6. So hopefully he's just going to stay on your website looking for another product. But in the worst case, he's just going to leave your website and you just lost on the click. So what we sometimes do, or what we recommend, is to, for example, exclude the whole product from your product feed. So that you can just, for example, set up a rule that, let's say, if more than 70% of all your product variants are sold out, then in this case, I would like to remove the whole Adidas sneaker from your data feed. Exactly. So it's very crucial also to know your markets. Just take a look what your competitors do. Just take a look at the price they offer. Try to optimize the campaigns. It's super important also. Sometimes people optimize the feed, but forget to optimize the Google Shopping campaign, or the other way around, that they just think that I will just give a high CPC, but they just forget about optimizing the data feeds. And that's why we are actually developing right now Let's go to the next slide. That's why we actually, we are working right now on a new feature called Price Watch and Data Feed Watch, where we will be able to check how you are doing with the pricing of your product in comparison to the pricing of your competitors on different channels. And based on this information, you will be also able to, for example, exclude some products which are not performing well, where you, for example, see that a competitor is offering the same product for a way lower price, and that you can, for example, not do this. So in this case, you can just exclude this product, or you can just adjust the pricing of your product. Yeah, so it's also a way how to use your data feeds wisely, how to check your product data and the pricing in comparison to what other people on the market do. And also here, create a custom label, just push the best products where you just see, okay, they are doing well in comparison. So just push them, optimize the CPC and optimize the campaign. This is all about, this was actually just a part of about data feed optimization. Every one of you is welcome to contact me at any time. We can definitely take a look at your data feed. We can take a look at your shop. And we at Data Feed Watch also offer a data feed ebook, where you can just read some tips and tricks about how to optimize your data feed for Google Shopping and different other channels. This one is available on our website, datafeedwatch.com. You will find it there, and this ebook is for free. You can read it at any time. And if you will have any questions or you will need any help with creating a data feed, you can just contact me at any time.
Amazing. Thank you so much. There's a lot of great information. I know there's been some things that have come through, people asking if they're going to get the slides after. Yeah. So many great tips. Yes, we'll be sending those out after. So no worries about that. Some quick summary points before we wrap up. Starting to sell B2C now is really the best time. It's kind of now or never. I think that sometimes people think, you know, we're going to do this in the future. But given how quickly things are shifting with the current environment, you really want to capitalize on this now and just build it out better and better over time. It's better to use Google Shopping Standard, still don't like that name, let's just call it the extraordinary version, than the smart or free version. I still think you should do the free version. I mean, it's quote unquote free. Even if it's just 3% of the traffic, why wouldn't we do it? You're just going to have more strategy beyond that if you're really looking to move this channel. There is a clear advantage in having more control in that you can utilize the data to your benefit. You can see how all the different pieces are playing into it, from your devices to your audiences, and then you have more information on that data to be able to take it and apply it to other aspects of your business. Reporting is obviously a must. You don't want to just be doing things in vain. You need to understand how it's affecting the overall scheme of things. The data quality is going to be a huge success factor, like Martin was talking about. And one of the biggest takeaways we always see with the feeds and when we're working with Data Feed Watch is that the title is most important, kind of that old school left to right rule, the most important in the front, and then as you go on. Testing is the most important thing in most digital marketing things, but in this specifically as well, everything from the way you're setting up your feed, the custom labels that you're putting in there, the different types of promos that you're doing, and then how we import that all to actually serve out for your shopping campaigns. So the more data, the better, and make sure that you're utilizing that feed data to benefit you in the best way possible. A few more quick takeaways. Both Finch and Data Feed Watch do offer free demos and free audits, so we can actually take a look at your specific accounts and data and see how things are stacking up, what's going really well, maybe areas that can improve, and at the very least, you get a little bit more information about your accounts. So I would encourage you to take advantage of that. And at this point, we're going to open it up to Q&A. I know a number of those have come in. And then also, I just want to encourage you after, there'll be a survey. If you can fill that out, we really enjoy putting on events like this and want to make sure that it's a good use of everyone's time. So if you have a few minutes to fill that out, we would appreciate it. So let's turn it over to the questions. I have multiple sources where they have come in, so I will look at those now. This one is for you, Martin. You mentioned Magento and Shopify. What about integrations with other platforms such as EpiServer?
EpiServer, we don't support yet. But right now we're actually supporting different shopping carts like Magento, Shopify, WooCommerce. But you can also just upload a simple Google spreadsheet, or you can just generate a CSV or XML file out of your system, out of your shopping system. And then it will be just uploaded via a link to DataFeedWatch. So even if we don't have the direct integration via API with these kind of shopping carts, you can just generate a link out of your shopping cart and just paste in the link into DataFeedWatch, and then we will automatically download all product data at least every day. Yeah, but we are still adding more and more shopping carts. So right now we are, for example, working on shopping carts like Shopware and PrestaShop, but Magento, Shopify, there is no issue. We are just managing this with a lot of clients actually.
Great. Another question for you, Martin. This person runs a rather small shop with only 100 products currently. Would you still recommend a data feed management tool?
Yes, of course. So many people actually don't know like how to optimize the data feeds, and it's very simple with any kind of data feed management tool. So I don't have just clients like big clients like Adidas, but I also have clients with a small shop with just like 30 products. The easy thing is that you can just very easily connect your data, your shopping cart, your shop system with DataFeedWatch. And then within just one platform, within just one interface, you will be able to generate the different data feeds at the same time. So here we were just talking about Google Shopping, but you can also create with the same product feed you just upload to us, also feeds for Bing, for Amazon, for eBay within just a few clicks. So yeah, if you would like to advertise on different channels, not just in Google Shopping, but different other channels, it's actually super easy with a data feed management tool like ours.
Awesome, thank you. I can take this next one. What if you don't have a data feed? Can I still run campaigns on Google Shopping? So you do actually need that feed to advertise on the shopping. You can do the search side without a feed because that's all run off from keywords. So you're just bidding on different types of keywords. But the shopping is actually pulled from that data feed. That's how things serve up because, like I said, you can't bid on keywords. So in order to have relevant search results, they're looking at what information you're sending in the feed. And if you don't have that currently set up, that's something that Finch can certainly advise on. Different shopping platforms usually have various plugins or different ways that you can pull that out pretty quickly. And then we, along with DataFeedWatch, can get it optimized so it's in the best place possible. So for Google Shopping, you do need a feed. And also for that free version, you need a feed. So it's in your best interest to set it up. Next question, which other channels besides Google Shopping do you recommend? I think it's so different based on what you're trying to achieve as a company. If you are an e-commerce client, then you probably do want to take advantage of all the different platforms out there. That's the beautiful thing with digital. I mean, you're going to see if it's working or if it's not. So if you started on Bing search and shopping, or if you want to do some type of display in the DSP world, which we've set up in a way that's very conversion driven, you can do all these different things and you're going to have the data as to how it's producing for you. So I would say if you're looking to break into this digital marketing world, it behooves you to have really this comprehensive digital marketing strategy where we're really starting at the top of the funnel and pushing all the way down. And then you can test things and you can see the results and figure out what's working for you, maybe where you want to shift more budget. If you're meeting those types of returns that you need, then ultimately you don't want to be shutting that off. It's kind of just keep pushing it until you hit points of diminishing returns.
And one thing I would like to add here, it actually depends on which country you are selling. So for example, just take a look at your market, which shopping cart, which channel or which marketplace is doing better in which country. So most of our clients in the US market actually use Google Shopping, Facebook product ads, Amazon Marketplace. Then in other European countries, like for example, Germany, then it's more like eBay, idealo.de, but you can also have like bol.com and other marketplaces in different countries.
Yeah, excellent point. Next question for you, Martin. Where is the competitor price data coming from? Is this Google's benchmark?
Mostly, yes. Mostly, it's Google. It's Google's benchmark. We're actually still working on this. So the Price Watch feature I just mentioned here at DataFeed Watch, it's still on the beta version. So if any one of you would be interested in testing this, just ping me and we can give you access to that. And then we will definitely also give you some more info about Price Watch and how it works.
Awesome. Another Price Watch question. If you exclude products based on the Price Watch tool, is there a chance they can return in the feed again?
Yes. So we are trying to automate everything as much as possible so that, for example, bad performing products will be automatically excluded. But if, let's say, the price will be competitive again, they will definitely come back into the data feed and will be uploaded the next time with the data feed to Google Shopping or to Bing or to Amazon again. So yes.
This next question we can probably both attack. If you want to start, Martin, how does all this work if we are selling in 10 plus countries with various languages?
It's actually quite easy. There are different apps and websites where you can just translate the content of your website. So let's say if you haven't translated the content of your website yet, so let's say it's just in English, then we, for example, work closely together with Weglot and with Langify. So especially if you use Shopify, you can just install the Langify app. And in this case, the whole content from your shop will be translated into other languages. And then when we just connect your store with DataFeed Watch, we download all the product data to DataFeed Watch. With all product data, I mean, for example, that then in this case, the description will be in English, in German, in French, in Italian. And then when you just do the mapping for the fields, so let's say you would like to advertise in Google Shopping DE in Germany, then you just select from the list Germany, Google Shopping DE, and then with the mapping of the fields, you just need to find the right information in the right language. So in this case, it would be title DE, description DE, so that you will definitely have this in the right language. And this is how it's super easy to advertise in different countries. But then, of course, the other way around, you just need to think about your business, like how you're going to do the payment, the shipping of your product, and so on. But I think in our today's possibilities, it's very easy to handle this. Yeah. So, like as I said, Weglot and Langify, these are the most common apps and websites how to translate the content.
Exactly. And then at Finch, we're very much a global company. So you would have a client success manager maybe in the language or where your headquarters are in that country. But if we needed to pull in other native speakers, we can. But to Martin's point, it's all pretty much streamlined to be able to serve that in various languages, currencies, all that fun stuff.
Exactly.
Next question. Have you done any A/B testing of the performance of your granular setup versus smart shopping? Good question. I don't know what you've seen on your end. We have done a fair amount at Finch. It's interesting results. Like I mentioned, you can't necessarily take it just apples to apples because smart shopping isn't necessarily just shopping. So if you were just taking shopping and looking at that and then comparing it to the smart shopping, there's other components that are being added into that. So if we look at all those different channels that we're managing, so say on the Finch side, we manage shopping and then we're doing the dynamic remarketing. We have YouTube placements and all that. Once we can start to look at that bigger picture, we have seen that it comes out, if not on even up. And I think the biggest benefit on having the Finch side and having that granular approach and that access to the information is the fact that you have all of that data. So for various reasons, whatever it might be, if you have different goals, we have the ability to control that and apply it to other aspects of your business, whether it's everything from your email marketing, your organic approach, we can kind of utilize that information all encompassing as opposed to just putting it in smart shopping and letting it run, but not really understanding how anything is getting there. It'll also be interesting because it's still a fairly new offering. As it gets bigger and more people are getting on it, there's less inventory to specifically just serve for that. Maybe there's more competitors on it. So now you're kind of going up with the same technology and the same approach as many other people. It'll just be interesting as that starts to unfold what that looks like. I don't know, Martin, if you ever see it on your side, if you've seen different setups versus smart shopping or not, or you don't necessarily look as much into that since you guys are more on the back end?
Unfortunately not.
Yeah. And we're happy to discuss that further if you want to have a follow-up and just kind of look at some of the comparisons that we've seen. More questions. Oh, my screen just skipped. How can we optimize the shopping campaign using the data feed watch? Maybe we tag team this again. If you want to do a quick recap on that, Martin, and then I can jump in.
I actually don't see the question here, but where is it? Any Q&A?
So just asking overall in general, how do you optimize your shopping campaign when you're powered by data feed watch?
Yeah, exactly. So like I just said, like the data feed itself is just a foundation. So first of all, then more information than you will just have in your data feeds will definitely help you to improve the content of your Google Shopping campaign, and also will help you to lower your CPC, but will help you to be on a better positioning on Google Shopping. So this is the one thing. And then the other thing, we can just take a look together into your Google Shopping campaign and also help you to optimize this a little bit. But like as I said, the content, first of all, we will take a look together into your data feeds, optimize it, add some more information and values to the data feeds so that you will definitely have a good quality feed with way more information in it.
Yeah. And I think on the Finch side, it's just really having that foundation be in a good place. So I was trying to think of a good analogy. Like, let's say you're a runner and you've decided to run your first 5K race. It's really in having that the optimized feed. Now we have the right shoes. We're wearing the right gear. We've done some training. So we're in a good place to run that race and use all of the data that we've been practicing and where we know we have strengths and weaknesses to kind of present you with the best option to succeed. How does Finch handle a wide variety of products, but not many of each combined with season? Good question. So we do have a fair number of clients that have a lot of products, but let's say a specific example I can think off the top of my head is a high-end jewelry company. So they aren't selling $50,000 watches every single day. They might sell one and then of another kind. So what we do there, and this is the nice thing with having the custom labels and whatnot, is really aggregate the data based on how we can group things and start to extrapolate out how they can perform so that we can have appropriate bids. At the end of the day, it does kind of come down to data. So if it is spread out, you have to get a little bit more creative with groupings and lumping things together and then doing a lot of that testing and switching. So our system actually runs every single night. If it doesn't have enough data, it'll run through a number of different scenarios based on different pieces of the feed and those custom labels to say, okay, if we group these things together, what's our possible outcome? If we group these things together, what's our possible outcome? And it will keep doing that until we do get enough data. Same thing with seasonality. We actually have seasonality settings in the software. So we'll start to learn, even if you haven't been with us for a full year, we can manually input that. So let's say that, you know, Mother's Day is a huge day for you, just using the jewelry example again. We can know that during that time, we really need to pump things up, but maybe during the middle of the summer where there aren't, you know, Mother's Day, Valentine's Day, Christmas, it's not as big. So we have those type of seasonality settings built right into the software. Okay.
Yeah, the next question is regarding boil.com.
Yeah.
I just replied to your message there. Just feel free to reach out to our Benelux country manager, Pavel. He speaks Dutch, if you speak Dutch, so you can just talk to him. And he's actually our expert in marketplaces like Amazon and boil.com. So just feel free to reach out to him and he will definitely get back to you as soon as possible.
Perfect. And this last one is kind of a comment question. You can break out your products individually in smart shopping and still see how they're doing. You just don't see which platforms you're serving on and don't see search terms. But for me, that has worked well in smart shopping. That's true. You definitely can. The only other aspect of that is you can't really see any of the other stuff. So you can't see any of the device modifiers. You can't see any of the audience modifiers. For us at Finch, we use that a lot for other information. So we do a lot on the DSP network with prospecting and remarketing, and using that type of audience information makes a big difference for us to be able to dictate the rest of the digital marketing strategy. So definitely, if you're kind of just wanting to do this one thing, that might be great for you. If you do need to extrapolate it out and apply it to a larger digital marketing strategy, that type of information might be really important. Oh, one final question. We've been asked about pricing. So both for DataFeed Watch and Finch. Do you want to go first, Martin?
Yeah, thank you. Regarding the pricing, we handle this a little bit. Let's say we charge due to the amount of products you upload to DataFeed Watch. So we have three different subscriptions. Let's say if we have more than 100,000 products, then we would just create an individual enterprise plan for you and give you some discount on this. But in general, we have like something called like shop subscription, merchant, and agency subscription. And to give you an overview, let's say if you have two shops with 5,000 products in total, you can advertise on 10 different channels. Like you can create 10 different data feeds for $59 per month. If you go on the agency plan for $179 per month, you can upload an unlimited number of shops and you can create up to 150 channels, and 30,000 products are already included there. So this is, for example, quite good for, let's say, agencies who have different clients and would like to keep all shops and all data feeds in just one data feed watch account, so they can just go for the agency subscription. But if you have, let's say, a smaller shop, then it will be just around $34, $59, like maximum $100 per month, I think. Yeah, but there's like no limits. Like as I said, if you have more than 100,000 products, we are of course able to handle this, and we will definitely give you a nice pricing there.
Perfect. And actually, if you are working with Finch, we include the data feed watch optimization. You don't pay for that separately. We just offer that as part of our service because we want to make sure that we have that solid feed so that we can get the best foot to go forward. And then overall, Finch services are charged by a percentage of spend. So if we did an audit, we would kind of see what the historical has been and figure out the percentage from there. So there's no startup fee and there's no like monthly retainer like a more traditional agency. It's just a percentage of spend, and it is designed to scale. So essentially, the more you're spending, the lower your fee gets. Perfect. I think that is all the questions for now. I know a lot of times things come up after the fact, so there will be the information sent out, the slides, so that you can have that. And if you have additional follow-up questions, please reach out. We're here for that. We both have teams that can help answer all of that. And yeah, we're very appreciative that everyone spent this time with us. Hope you got a lot of good information, and we'll see you next time. And thank you, Martin, for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thanks everyone for joining this webinar today. Yeah, and hope to see you soon again.
Perfect. Have a good one.
You too. Bye.
Bye-bye.